Hi everyone. In this video, I'm going to quickly run through some of the essential topics of signals and systems. These are the things that I think is absolutely essential for a student to know when preparing for an exam or for someone working in signals analysis. If you're looking for full videos with full explanations, you can find those on my website, iancollings.com. You'll find a categorized listing of all the videos on the channel. Of course, subscribe to the channel for more videos in future. That really helps the channel. And if you're interested, you can follow me on Instagram and Facebook, where I'm in a bit of a search to find signals in everyday life. This is a two-part video, so let's crack on with part one. Let's start by considering a generic function. And here I've got a time-based function. The first essential thing to point out is that the thing in the brackets is just a variable. And I can actually replace that by anything I like without changing the shape of the function. That's a very important concept to be able to understand. So here I'm going to replace it by alpha. G of alpha has exactly the same shape. Now, alpha may or may not have a physical interpretation like time did, but that doesn't matter. I can just take the t, as long as everywhere I see t, I replace it by alpha, that function remains the same. That's a very important concept. Let's look at a very specific function. So let's take the delta function. That's another essential element. So I'm going to draw here delta of t minus 2. So this is delta t minus 2 here. It's at time 2 and has an area equal to 1. So this first thing to say about this is this function is not just the spike at 2. This is a function over all time. That's a very important concept. So it actually equals 0 everywhere else, and it's important not to forget about that. So why is that? Let's see that in action, because we are interested in using it for sampling. So let's look at the sampling property of the delta function. If we have a generic function here, x of t, then x of t might look like this. If we multiply these two functions together, it's very important that you understand and know what's happening, and that's where this zero is very important, because all of this function for all values of time, other than where that spike is, you're going to be multiplying by zero. If you remember that the delta function exists at all time, it's zero over all of these times here. So when you multiply these two functions together, you're going to get a function which is zero everywhere except for where that delta was. And so the result is still going to be a delta function at the same time. It's going to have a different magnitude, and the magnitude will be given by x at that time. So if I write that out in mathematics here, x of t, which is a function, times delta t minus 2, which is a function, equals the delta function at t minus 2. It's still a delta function at time 2, but now the magnitude of that delta function is given by the number x of 2. And so here we've got a function times a function, and it equals a function, the delta function, times a number. This number here, x of 2, is just simply the number, the value of the x function at time 2. So it's very important to understand the difference between a function and a number. And this is what we call sampling. That's the sampling property. So that's very important. Okay, let's look at the convolution in signals and systems. So here we've got what's going to be important about that. Well, of course, it's important to know what convolution is. I'm not going to go into that here, but I am going to make an important point about convolution. So let's say we had a function here. So let's say y of t, and it looks like this, for example. It goes between 0 and t, for example. Now, what would happen if we convolved y of t with a delta function? So this is another property of a delta function, an essential property that's essential to know for doing all sorts of analysis in signal processing. Okay, so the convolution of this function here, yt, with that function there, delta t minus 2, it's an important property to know, is that when you convolve with a delta function, the zero parameter of your function becomes located at the location of the delta function. That's an important thing. Even if you don't know the mathematics, you should be remembering that. The zero of the function gets located at the location of the delta function. So here the result of convolving yt, so yt convolved with delta t minus 2 equals a function which where the 0 from here gets located at the location of the delta function. So you know it will be a, in this case, a square function where this is between 2 and t plus 2. You didn't even need to do any mathematics to do that if you remember that property. That's an essential property of signals and systems, is that when you convolve with a delta function, the 0 of your function goes. Some people think that the function gets centered over the location of the delta function. So I've deliberately drawn this one here to the right-hand side, not a square centered on 0, to highlight for you it's not that that somehow the center of this square gets located at the delta function. It's the 0 parameter. So where time equals 0, in this case it's time, when time equals 0, that gets located where the 2 is. That's a very important property to know about signals and systems. Okay, what about another important function? So let's think about the step function. And all I just do here is just to remind people what it is. So the step function, wherever you see u of t, it's like where we saw delta of t, we knew that that was a spike. When we see u of t, we know that it is the step function. And again, the step function equals 0 for all negative time and equals 1 for all positive time. It's not that it only exists in positive time. It does exist for negative time. It's just that it equals 0. And that's a very important property not to overlook. Okay, what about something else? Another important thing to be able to do in signals and systems is to be able to sketch the cos and the sine waveform. And so you should be able to sketch exactly the cos waveform, exactly as I'm doing now, just as freehand like this, exactly as accurately. It starts at 1, it goes to negative 1 and goes back to 1 over a period of 2 pi. And I'm going to plot this with respect to alpha here just to show the generic value. So this is cos of alpha. And you should be able to plot sine as well. So sine of alpha starts at 0 and goes through a full period over a time period 2 pi. This is essential things to be able to know straight without even thinking about. You should be able to plot these down. Now, I put the alpha here again a bit like this. The thing in the brackets we can replace with anything that we like. So let's use that property here to see about something about the period and some other important properties. So let's say, for example, we let alpha equal omega t. Okay, so now it's a time-based function. So here it was just sometimes people put theta here and it has the connotation of a fixed angle. But really it's just the thing in the brackets. It's just the thing we're plotting against. So now I'm going to let it be given by something that's time-based. So as time increases, the value of alpha will increase. It means you will move to the right along here at a rate that's given by omega. And this is related, of course, to the frequency. This is the angular frequency. So let's take an example here. So let's say alpha equaled 4 pi t. Let's just take that one for an example. So cos of 4 pi t. What do we learn from this? Well, we can learn about the period. We can know the period and therefore the frequency of this. How can we see that? Because here we've got alpha equal 4 pi t. We know that it's gone through an entire period over 2 pi. So what's the value of time that corresponds to an entire period for this value of alpha here for a waveform that is cos, let me write the waveform here, cos of 4 pi t. So if you saw cos of 4 pi t, what is the frequency? How do we know the frequency? Well, we know that it's gone through a full period over 2 pi. So when the thing in the brackets equals 2 pi, it will have done a full period. So therefore, the thing in the brackets equals 4 pi t. When that equals 2 pi, then it will be a full period. So let me replace t by a capital T, because we can call that the period. So that implies that for this waveform, cos of 4 pi t, the period equals 2 pi divided by 4 pi, which equals a half, which means the frequency of that waveform equals 1 divided by t. That's 2 hertz. Okay, and we can see here that the angular frequency, omega, was 4 pi, and the frequency in terms of cycles per second is 2. And this is just an example, but in general, another important, absolutely critical thing to remember and know about is that omega equals 2 pi f. Okay, that's the relationship between omega and F, it's absolutely vital that you know about that. It's an essential element of knowing signals and systems. Okay, what about, so we've got convolution, delta functions, we've got cos waves. What about the Fourier transform? Well, let's think about the Fourier transform of cos, another essential thing to know about. And you should be able to plot the Fourier transform of cos without even having any mathematics, without any formulas. So here's what it is, and here's why it is and how you should know this. In the frequency domain, we know that cos only contains a single frequency component. Exactly, in this case, it was 4 pi in omega, or 2 hertz. So there's only one frequency. And it's absolutely essential to know that the Fourier transform tells you about the frequency components of a signal. So if there's only one frequency component, then you will get only one value. And we have positive and negative values. And so this would be +2 and -2. And there's two spikes. We've got positive and negative. The height will be 1/2. This is something you should absolutely know without needing a formula sheet or without needing any mathematics, okay? And this is this should make sense because you probably remember cos of alpha. This is sort of another essential thing for doing these kinds of problems and doing analysis. Remember that cos of alpha can be written as an expansion of e to the j alpha plus 1/2 e to the minus j alpha. It's 1/2 there and 1/2 there. That is a trigonometric expression. And you can see it here because we've got the positive alpha, the negative alpha. If alpha here was replaced by 4 pi t, as you see, the thing in the brackets gets replaced, you're going to have 2 and 2 with a power of a half, with a height of 1/2 because of here. And another thing we should point out here, another essential thing is I've used j here. Of course, it's essential to know that for signals and systems, the complex value I, sometimes called j, is the square root of -1, another essential element of signals and systems. Mathematicians use I, electrical engineers use j because they use I for the current, and this equals the complex number, the square root of -1, another essential thing to know about. Okay, so what is another thing, getting nearer to the end here of this part one? And another thing to know is you absolutely should know what a rect function is. So a rect function is a square function. I'll draw it with time here. And if I put it over a period capital T there, this is given by the expression RECT, rect of T divided by capital T. So it's absolutely essential to know that that function, rect of T divided by capital T, that tells you that the width of the square is capital T. It's just very important to know that. And you don't need a formula book. As soon as you remember, the thing on the denominator of the rect expression tells you the width of the square. Another thing essential to know is related to this is about the sinc function. So the sinc function looks like this. It's essential to know that. Sinc, I'm going to draw sinc of alpha here. And I'm going to plot it, of course, with respect to alpha. And it's important to know that not only what it looks like, but it's important to know that these zero crossings are the same distance apart and that they are at a distance apart of 1. So when you've got sinc of alpha plotted with alpha, the first zero crossing is 1. The second zero crossing is 2 and 3 and so on. It's important to know that. There's often wanting to know these widths of this thing, of this sinc function here, and you can get easily tricked if you start thinking about time scaling and or frequency scaling if it's in the frequency domain, all these sort of things. But if you just remember for a sinc function where the thing in the brackets is the thing you're plotting against, then the first zero crossing is at 1. Okay, another thing to know about, and I'll use this as an example with the Fourier transform, is that if you expand in one domain, you contract in the other and vice versa. So here, for example, if we took a rect function, well, first of all, to say that it's essential to know that the Fourier transform of a square function, a rect, is a sinc function. So that's important to know. These are a Fourier transform pair. So now let's go to this expansion. If I expand in the time domain, then I contract in the frequency domain. That's another essential thing to know. Again, you don't need any mathematics for that to know that property. It's often that property enough is enough to help you answer problems and work out things about bandwidth, for example. If this was a time domain digital clock and it clocked at a slower rate, then it would use less bandwidth because these two are a Fourier transform pair, okay? And as we say, that it also works in reverse. If we made this narrower in time, then this would be expanded in frequency. So that's a very important property to know about. Another property with the Fourier transform is coming back to our convolution. An absolutely essential property to know about is that convolution in the time domain is the equivalent to multiplication in the frequency domain. And that is absolutely vital to know that for signals and systems. And this is how we write it here. The convolution in the time domain is equivalent to multiplication in the frequency domain. And an important thing from here is that follows from here is that, make another important essential point is that linear time invariant systems, LTI systems, the filter, a linear time invariant system can be viewed as a filter, and these systems perform convolution. So linear time invariant systems does a convolution. And what that tells you then is that because of this property here, is that the transfer function in the frequency domain of an LTI system is equal to the Fourier transform of the output divided by the Fourier transform of the input from exactly this property here. Because LTI systems do convolution in the time is multiplication in the frequency. So if you want to know HF, you can take the Fourier transform of the output, divide it by the Fourier transform of the input. It's an absolutely essential property to know about. And one other property around this to know about is that for linear time invariant systems is that if your input signal is a sinusoid, so I'll say here cos, and maybe we use an example here, the 2 pi F1t. So again, this is cos over here. We're now setting alpha up here to be 2 pi F1, like at a particular frequency. So if a cos wave goes into a linear time invariant system, it comes out at exactly the same frequency. And you can see that from this formula here, because if the input is a cos wave, then it has this shape down here. There's two delta functions, but there's only one frequency component. That frequency component gets multiplied by the transfer function, but does not get shifted in any way. It's simply a multiplication. So yt will equal cos 2 pi f1t. The frequency doesn't change, but the amplitude and the phase will change as given by h of f. And exactly what we see here, again, this sampling property can be viewed from the delta function. The cos function only has these two frequencies. So when it multiplies in the frequency domain, when it multiplies by h of f, because the input only has those two deltas if it's a cos input, when it multiplies by h of f, it has the property of sampling h of f at that particular frequency, at the place where the delta function is. So that's why you're getting an output at the same frequency, but it's going to be given by the amplitude, as we saw here, the amplitude of the function. So it's going to have a phase, a particular phase, which is given by h at that frequency, and is going to have a particular amplitude. Let's call it beta. So cos waves go in to linear time invariant systems, come out as cos waves, but with amplitude and phase shifted. So in part one, we've now covered the essentials of signals and systems in terms of functions and the Fourier transform. And for part two, we'll be looking at sampling and Laplace transforms and Z transforms. So if you found this video helpful, please hit the like button. It helps others to find it. Subscribe to the channel for more videos. That really helps. And of course, check out the description below where you'll find a web page which has a full categorized listing of all the videos on the channel.